Many of you in this audience will have had occasion this week to attend one of the dedication sessions of the Mount Tipinogos Temple. In that wonderful setting, we raised our voices and sung an hymn, The Spirit of God, Like a Fire is Burning, first in that March 1836 setting of the Kirtland Temple dedication. I love those words. Part of the pertinent part I'll read and share again. The visions and blessings of old are returning, and angels are coming to visit the earth. And isn't it marvelous that that has been the case? Through the Doctrine and Covenants and the truths proclaimed therein, we learn many things pertaining to the mission, the ministry, and message of these divine and holy ministrants of God we call angels. I love what Elder Jeffrey R. Holland said in connection with an invitation extended to Latter-day Saints to learn more of the work of angels. He said in a 1994 address, Church Education Instructors, I believe that we need to speak of and believe in and bear testimony to the ministry of angels more than we sometimes do. They constitute one of God's great methods of witnessing through the veil. Perhaps more than any other image, the figure of an angel, specifically an angel with a trumpet in hand, has come to symbolize the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. Temples the world over have been adorned at their pinnacle with that golden messenger of old, Moroni, conveying the idea of the restoration through the ministry of angels. I have to pause here and share just a note again. I think of President Hinckley, who again in this week's dedication, in the session that I was in attendance to, making reference to that angel Moroni and encouraging the youth of the church to include that as a focus and encouragement and a motivation to do good, asking them to eye that temple upon the temple and let that be a reminder to them of their covenants. Now, the term angel means messenger of God. In ancient days, as in modern times, and throughout the history of mankind, angels have come to bear messages and have carried keys. More than half of the books of the Bible, in fact, make reference to to angels and their missions. And throughout that text, we have wonderful instances. I think of the Savior's earthly ministry as probably that greatest of examples. From the moment of the Annunciation until the ascension of our Savior, think of the involvement of angels in his mortal experience, and many times in between. The Book of Mormon, too, includes much that can benefit us in terms of understanding the mission and teachings of angels. Moroni, quoting his father, closed out his record saying, For behold, God, knowing all things, being from everlasting to everlasting, behold, he sent angels to minister to the children of men, to make manifest concerning the coming of Christ. Wherefore, by the ministering of angels and by every word which proceedeth forth out of the mouth of God, men began to exercise faith in Christ. And thus by faith they did lay hold upon every good thing, and thus it was until the coming of Christ. Speaking of that first coming to the Western Hemisphere. Moroni then boldly testifies of the work of angels as he continues on to say, Neither have angels ceased to minister unto the children of men, for behold, they are subject unto him, and minister according to the word of his command, showing themselves unto them of strong faith and a firm mind in every form of godliness. As powerful as each book of Scripture is in proclaiming the truths regarding angels, no Scripture surpasses the Doctrine and Covenants in clarifying teachings regarding angels and demonstrating their influence in the gospel of Jesus Christ. Herein, profound truths are declared relative to the activities of angels amongst men in both ancient and modern times. In our hour together, we will seek to discuss at least a handful of questions pertaining to the mission of angels. First, who are angels? What is their identity? What is the mission of angels? To whom do angels minister? And finally, what is the message of proclaimed by angels in our day? Let's begin with that first area. Who are angels? Well, modern-day revelation teaches us much about the nature of angels. We know for a surety that they are included within those numbered as sons and daughters of God spiritually. In fact, the Doctrine and Covenants teaches that there are no angels who minister to this earth, but those who do belong or have belonged to it. That from section 130 of the Doctrine and Covenants. Thus we know that these heavenly messengers are in reality a part of our earthly family too. This has a great power when we consider the Elijah principle of turning the hearts of the fathers to their children and the children to their fathers as these divine messengers return to earth. An understanding of angels requires a knowledge of the different usages of the term angel. Typically, when we speak of angels, we speak of beings possessed of bodies of flesh and bones, and generally of two kinds, those translated and those resurrected. The Doctrine and Covenants teaches about angels that they do not reside on a planet like the earth, but they reside in the presence of God, on a globe like a sea of fire, of glass and of fire, where all things for their glory are manifest, past, present, and future, and are continually before the Lord. That again from section 130. Further, with reference to translated beings, we know that Christ told John the Beloved that he would be as a flaming fire and a ministering angel. He shall minister for those who shall be heirs of salvation who dwell on earth. Section 7. Another messenger of the Lord that is often referred to is a ministering spirit. As pertaining to spirits, they are of two kinds. The unembodied spirits, those not yet having been born into mortality, and the disembodied, who after mortality are yet awaiting the resurrection. Of those who are not resurrected, also known as the spirits of just men made perfect, section 129 of the Doctrine and Covenants teaches that they will inherit the same glory as angels. In other words, a celestial glory. The distinction between angels and spirits of the just can be made through understanding of Joseph Smith's teachings and teachings of the prophet Joseph Smith, page 325. Therein he says, spirits can only be revealed in flaming fire and glory. Angels have advanced further, their light and glory being tabernacled, and hence they appear in bodily shape. Angels have advanced higher in knowledge and power than have spirits. One clear difference between angels of the flesh and those ministering spirits, which we've just referred to, would be in the area of the duties they can perform. While messengers in the spirit may convey messages of hope, of reassurance, of calming, and sometimes correction, on those occasions where keys of the priesthood have been returned to the earth, such as John the Baptist's visit or that of Peter, James, and John, translated or resurrected beings would have been required inasmuch as spirits do not have the capacity to lay their hands upon heads in this sphere. Other uses of the term angel are worth mentioning. They are found in the scriptures and ought to be mentioned to avoid confusion, although we do not have time to discuss them at any great length today. In several cases, the Lord himself proclaims himself to be an angel in his messenger capacity. Additionally, we have the term applied occasionally to mortal messengers as they convey messages of divine origin. And then there are those angels who are relegated to be angels in throughout eternity because of the failure to observe the principles in connection with the oath and covenant associated with the covenant of marriage, eternal marriage. And finally, we ought to make mention in passing of those those angels whose wages are paid by Satan himself, which we sometimes refer to angels of the devil. Now, at the head of this dispensation, Joseph Smith was privileged to receive instruction from various sources. Of Joseph Smith's relationship with these heavenly beings, John Taylor said it well when he said, "The principles which he, Joseph Smith, had placed him in communication with the Lord, and not only with the Lord, but with the ancient apostles and prophets. Such men, for instance, as Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Noah, Adam, Seth, Enoch, and Jesus, and the Father, and the apostles that lived on this continent, as well as those who lived on the Asiatic continent." And then this key comment, "He seemed to be as familiar with these people as we are with one another." Quite an endorsement of the prophet Joseph's mission. Now, perhaps the single greatest description we have of an angel is that provided by Joseph Smith on the occasion of the September 23rd, 1823 visit of the angel Moroni. Some of you are familiar with that description. Let me share it with you. Joseph, recalling that event, says, "I discovered a light appearing in my room, which continued to increase until the room was lighter than at noonday, when immediately a personage appeared at my bedside standing in the air, for his feet did not touch the floor. He had on a loose robe of most exquisite whiteness. And it was whiteness beyond anything earthly I had ever seen, nor do I believe that any earthly thing could be made to appear as exceedingly white and brilliant. His hands were naked, his arms also, a little above the wrist. So also were his feet naked. I could discover that he had no other clothing on but this robe, and as it was open, I could see into his bosom. Not only was his robe exceedingly white, but his whole person was glorious beyond description, and his countenance was truly like lightning. Now notice the absence of any reference to wings. According to Joseph Smith, an angel of God never has wings. That from the teachings of the prophet Joseph Smith, 162. Through the words of Joseph Smith, then, we gain a clearer understanding of the appearance of angels. However, appearances can be deceiving. Angels of the devil may appear as messengers of light with the intent to deceive and mislead. Joseph Smith warned that, quote, not every spirit or vision or singing is of God. The Doctrine and Covenants, section 129, gives three grand keys by which you may know whether any administration is from God, from verse 9. Well, the test essentially works as follows. If a being were to visit you, you would ask to shake his hand. If he reciprocates and extends his hand, you can be sure that you are in the presence of a translated or a physical being, that because he is possessed of a body of flesh and bone. If the being is a spirit of a just man made perfect, he would not reciprocate to shake your hand, but still would convey the message which he bears. And finally, if you were in the presence of a being or minister of the devil, he would offer to shake your hand, but you would feel nothing inasmuch as there is no tangible body. Now this means that the discernment afforded to mortals has provided a security to saints in many circumstances. I love this quote. We'll go now to the mission of the angels and what that is as it pertains to us as Latter-day Saints. And this is from Elder John A. Woodsill, who says that the main service of angels on this earth is clearly to be helpers with mankind. They are watchmen, protecting and ministering to us in hours of need. What a great way and capture of the feeling there. Now we have just a few, if we can identify a few of the functions of angels in their mission. I would include with these that they are called to teach God's children. They are called to convey priesthood keys. We have several instances of that recorded in the Doctrine and Covenants. To be a protecting arm to the faithful, to carry forth his work, to gather the elect of God, to call the wicked to repentance, and finally to carry out the judgments of God. Now, ancient scripture proclaimed that there would be a restoration of the gospel of Christ through the ministration of angels. This is found in Revelation 14, 6 and 7, amongst other places. Surely this is one of the tests of the true church of God. Orson Pratt explained that, quote, if Joseph Smith had received the Book of Mormon without the ministration of angels and pretended that it was revelation from God, well, every person acquainted with the scriptures would have known him to be an imposter. At the commencement of this dispensation, countless angels visited Joseph Smith, conveying authority, keys, and teachings upon him, which were necessary for the establishment of the kingdom of God on earth in the last days. These ministering angels were foreordained in the premortal existence and had essential gospel keys while on earth and maintained them after their departure from mortality. Section 128 identifies a number of these holy ministrants. And again, what do we hear? Glad tidings from Cumorah, Moroni, an angel of from heaven, declaring in fulfillment of the prophets the book to be revealed. The voice of Michael on the banks of the Susquehanna, detecting the devil as he appeared as an angel of light. The voice of Peter, James, and John in the wilderness, declaring themselves as possessing the keys of the kingdom and the dispensation of the fullness of times. The voice of Michael, the archangel, the voice of Gabriel, of Raphael, of diverse angels, from Michael to Adam and down to the present time, all declaring their dispensation, their rights, their keys, their honors, their majesty and glory. Another facet of the divine role of angels is identified in the Doctrine and Covenants, section 86, in connection with the explanation of the Lord of the parable of the wheat and the tare. Herein is recorded that in the last days, angels are crying to the Lord day and night, who are ready and waiting to be sent forth to reap down the fields. Like the destroyed angels who took the firstborn of the ancient Egyptians, these angels are called upon to carry out the judgments of God. Now, on the occasion of the dedication of the Salt Lake Temple, President Wilford Woodruff said in connection with this thought, "What is the matter with the world today? What has created the change that are coming over the world? Why these terrible earthquakes, tornadoes, and judgments? What is the meaning of all these mighty events that are taking place?" And then this answer: "The meaning is these angels have been held for many years in the temple of our God and have got their liberty to go out and commence their mission and their work in the earth, and they are here today." Section 77 is a particularly key section in the description of the function of angels in that role. And if I can, I'll share just one or two glimpses in connection with it. They provide a great depth of understanding about the role of angels. We learn about the four angels spoken of in Revelation 7 as being those given power over the four parts of the earth to save life and to destroy. These are they who have the everlasting gospel to commit to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people, having power to shut up the heavens and seal upon life or cast down to regions of darkness. Now, there is more about that, and we could be blessed by further discussion here, but let us continue on. We know that destroying angels are loosened in full force until the gathering of Israel is accomplished in our day. Now, let's visit about the last area, if we could, and this one a key again. To whom do angels minister? Speaking of early saints in this dispensation, the Lord said, "But I say unto you, my angels shall go before you, and also my presence, and in time you shall possess the goodly land." That, of course, speaking of the saints and their search for Zion. Additionally, in his instructions to the early elders, called to labor as missionaries, the Lord said, "And whoso receiveth you, there I will be also. For I will go before your face. I will be on your right hand and on your left. And my spirit shall be in your hearts, and mine angels round about you to bear you up." Now we know that these angels are fulfilling these errands, and we know that some of them have a particular kinship upon those whom they minister. President Joseph F. Smith said, and I love this quote, "Our fathers and mothers, brothers, sisters, and friends who have passed away from this earth, having been faithful and worthy to enjoy these rights and privileges, may have a mission given them to visit their relatives and friends upon the earth again, bringing from the divine presence messages of love, of warning, of reproof or instruction to those whom they had learned to love in the flesh." As surely in our day, God's angels go before his people. They are round about us, but most often, I think we're unaware of their presence and sometimes even their influence. In his enumeration of the spiritual gifts, Moroni indicated that the beholding of angels and ministering spirits was one of those spiritual gifts. Hence, we might conclude that there are those of our Father's children who are endowed with a particular sensitivity and capacity to receive such messengers and their messages. Now, I must hasten to the end of our short time together, and I conclude with this last area. I indicated the last was. This is the last. Let me just share this. The message proclaimed by these heavenly angels transcends all of time. The blessing extended to mankind today from our Heavenly Father is to enjoy essentially the same blessing enjoyed by Adam, the patriarch of our human family, as he received from an angel the plan of salvation, the law of sacrifice in connection with it in the context of his time. The message of the gospel is the same to us and includes the plan of salvation and all things which pertain to our participation in it. I wish to conclude with these lyrics from one of our less often sung hymns, but lyrics which I nonetheless love, which might call our minds back to that revelation received by John on the Isle of Patmos as he declared that angel coming forth in our day. "I saw a mighty angel fly, to earth he bent his way, a message bearing from on high to cheer the sons of day. Truth is the message which he bears, the gospel's joyful sound, to calm our doubts and chase our fears and make our joys abound. My testimony resembles President John Taylor's relative to the operation of angels in our day, as he said, God lives and his eyes are over us and his angels are round about us, and they are more interested in us than we are in ourselves 10,000 times, but we do not know it. May we come to know it. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
A set of 4 video cassettes featuring 8 lectures from the 1996 Sperry Symposium, Doctrine and Covenants, A Book of Answers, is available from the BYU Creative Works catalog by calling 1-800-962-8061 or visit us online at the address on your screen. The cost is $29.95 plus shipping and handling.